Macmillan Audio presents The Lights Go Out in Lychford by Paul Cornell. Read for you by Emma Newman. One. The air contained the first chill of autumn. Judith Mawson knew it well. She was walking along the side of the playing field, by the allotments, carrying a bag. She didn't know what she was doing here. She stopped. She had known. She patted herself down. She was in her light coat and too cold, but she was always too cold. Her handkerchief was... where was it? Oh, tucked in her cuff, where she never kept it. Probably. Right. She must have come out here for some reason. She looked out over the playing fields and watched parents and children on the swings and slides. What day was it? No idea. How could she find out what she was doing here? Ah, the bag. She looked in it. It contained a sheaf of posters, a box of drawing pins, and a packet of blue tack. She picked out one of the posters. Lychford Festival. Bands, beer tent, fun run, children's shows. A great day out for the whole family. Well, that sounded hellish. She looked around and saw, ahead of her, a notice board. Ah, right. Got it. Someone must have signed her up for this. They must have realised how helpless she was feeling right now. Oh, give the old bugger something to do. Keep her busy. That's what they were thinking, when everyone in this town owed their lives to her, several times over. Oh, she'd just remembered a lot of things about who she was and what she did. And a lot of it was pretty damn surprising. She was the wise woman, the hedge witch, who'd bathed in the waters of the well in the woods decades ago, and had spent her days since protecting Lychford from the evil, or just very different in a probably evil sort of way, stuff beyond its invisible borders. But now those borders were basically gone, because her apprentice, Autumn, had made some big errors of judgment. Not the girl's fault. Judith's fault for not knowing what to do with an apprentice. She'd known she needed one because this forgetting had been going on a lot longer than she'd told people. Where had her power gone? Where had her knowledge gone? Into the forgetting, into the bloody past. Ever since they'd gone to rescue those idiots who'd strayed into the other worlds that surrounded Lychford. That had been too much for her, in the end. She'd carried the magic of this town on her back too long. If something big did come out of the darkness for them now, with the boundaries only makeshift replacements, did she have anything at all left in her to help? She was pretty sure she were all right at the moment, as she stared at this bloody notice board. But she was pretty sure she was okay most of the time. Then she'd find evidence that someone had been walking around in her body being stupid while she was away in cloud cuckoo land. And that weren't magic. That were just this useless porridge between her ears going off. She'd gone around the bingo the other night, sitting down at tables where she didn't know anyone, asking where her sister was. That was what her son, or whatever he were called, that was what he'd told her. She couldn't believe she'd been there. She'd yelled at him, of course she bloody had. Postering, that was what she was doing now. She shouldn't yell at him. At Sean, that was his name. She should do what Lizzie and Autumn said, because they were the only ones she had now, the only ones who could understand enough to help her. That must be why she was here at this bloody notice board, because she'd finally got to the point in her life where she'd do things for whoever asked because she were desperate. Didn't deserve help. Not after the life she'd had. Oh God, she was frightened. She was more scared of this than of anything she'd faced down in the dark of the woods across all those years. Come on, you stupid woman. Look at this board. Do the job. What have you got here? Every inch of the notice board was taken up with posters and postcards, film shows at the Fincham Hall, yoga classes. The History Society had a talk about the Civil War. Baby bounce at the library, the festival in the next town, Northcote. She recalled now that she'd seen several of these posters on the previous notice boards she'd visited. Well done, brain. Good effort, dear. Were any of these past their sell-by date? She realised she had no idea what day it was. She looked again at the poster she was meant to put up. It looked to be the final version, with all the attractions on it. The festival was in mid-September. She looked again in her bag and saw that she'd bought the Gazette, or found it. If this was the current one, it was the week of September 3rd, which meant... No, all of these events on the posters were still to come. So, what to do? Well, the History Society seemed to get everywhere. They laminated their posters and stapled them to posts. They wouldn't miss one or two. Judith pulled out the bolts from the notice board, swung back the double glass doors, took the poster down, crumpled it up, and put it in her pocket. There still wasn't room to put up hers, though. Bloody Northcote had no business putting up posters for their festival in Lychford. It wasn't like the Lychford Festival went over there and... Well, they might. Judith had no idea. But whatever, down it came. Still not quite enough room. The last person who'd posted here had arranged everything that was left with fiendish precision. The film show at the hall was summit by Agatha Christie, and Judith hated Agatha Christie, so... Finally, she had space to pin up the festival poster. She did so, and triumphantly swung the doors closed again. Her festival poster was now half obliterated by the wooden edges of each of the glass doors where they met in the middle. Judith glared at the notice board. She'd had no idea this job was going to be so bloody awkward. This didn't seem like anything she'd normally be getting up to. Normally, she'd be on those swings over there with her mum and dad. Where had they got to? Well, of course, they'd be at home, wouldn't they? What? Of course not. Where had that come from? No, couldn't think about that, didn't make sense. She turned and looked over to the playing fields. They weren't there. She could see the old cottages that had stood there, one of them falling into the others, where its thatched roof had burned. Marie Higgs had lived there, and Alex Saal, who'd left to go into the Merchant Navy. After she'd finished here, she'd go and knock on his door and see if he could come out to play. She realised there was a weight behind her, an odd sort of weight. No, come on, not an odd sort of weight at all. It was the kind of feeling she'd become used to, being the wise woman of Lychford all these years. All what years? No, no, had someone said summat? What had she been thinking about? Here, this was an urgent weight. It said there might be danger or opportunity. She turned to see. There was a path that led across the allotments, right over two of them, in fact. It had high hedges on both sides. It turned a sharp corner. It was lit by a different sun than was in the sky on this late summer day. A sad sun. An awful sun. The sort of sun that you got after a fire. The smell that went with it was the smell of approaching winter. The path didn't seem to be in this world at all. It weren't attached to anything. It was like one of her posters, one thing put on top of another. It had never been here, not as far as she knew.
"What's that?" she asked.
"It's new," said Doreen. Her sister was standing at the notice board with her. She had her hair like Doris Day and was wearing that blue and white striped dress she put on whenever they went down the hall for a dance.
"I thought 'twere," said Judith.
She realised she'd finished her task. The poster was up now, and she could see all of it, even if the lettering was so small she couldn't read all of it. She looked around again, and the cottages, the new path, and her sister were gone.
Well, that was what magic was like, wasn't it?
Probably. Where had the magic started and ended there? Where should she go now?
Home for a cup of tea.
But where was that? Where were her parents? If she kept walking, she decided, she would probably find what she was after.
"Dementia," said Sean Mawson. "Let's call it what it is, Reverend."
The Reverend Lizzie Blackmore realised that she had indeed been euphemising, something she never did when it was her elderly parishioners who were suffering. "I'm sorry," she said.
"No, well, it's hard to face, isn't it?"
Sean was still in his police uniform, sitting with a cup of tea at Lizzie's kitchen table in the vicarage. "That's why I wanted to talk to you about it. Apart from yourself, Autumn and I are the ones closest to your mum."
"The only ones who'll talk to her, you mean?"
He smiled as he said it. "And we were wondering how you planned to proceed." Lizzie realised that, again, that wasn't as direct as she wanted to be. "I mean, do you have power of attorney for Judith?"
"As of last week. I went to see Pete at Stanshaw and Kemp and got the papers together, and I took them over and had a sit-down with Mum. She nodded along and asked me to leave them with her so she could read them before she signed them. I didn't think she would, but when I came back, she had. I told her it was for the best. Then she told me that now I could do what I'd always wanted to do, put her away in a home and never have to see her again."
Sean kept smiling, but his eyes didn't. Lizzie closed her eyes. "I'm sorry. I hear that a lot from relatives in your position."
"Then a couple of minutes later, she asked me if I'd found those papers she'd signed. Then a couple of minutes after that, she told me I should stop bringing those papers over because she'd never sign them."
"So do you think consent here is complicated?"
"No. She signed them. It's sorted."
Lizzie wanted to say that she knew there was a lot more behind that typically concrete policeman's statement. But she didn't want to hurt Sean by getting him to plumb depths he didn't want to explore. He was middle-aged and had never married. He was the sort who still enjoyed, when he wasn't doing his job, being one of the lads down the pub. He'd probably trundle along to the end of his life just the same. He was probably thinking a lot about that now, thanks to his mum. They all were.
"I don't think," he continued, "we need to do this yet. She's still looking after herself, okay? But she's forgetting more and more. I went round there the other day, and she had 3 dinners sitting in the oven. She'd made it for herself 3 times."
"And are you thinking about how long it might be before she forgets to switch something off?" Lizzie was pretty sure neither Sean nor Judith's savings, if there were any, were enough for a home help.
"That had occurred to me. But I pop over every night to make sure she's okay. Like I said, it's not time yet."
"I'm sure you'll make the right choice, and we'll be here to help when you do."
"Thanks for that. There's a good retirement home in town, Ashdown House. I've had a look around in there and it were a sheer relief. Lots for them to do, a really good atmosphere. Though you do see ones who are just staring into space. Or who were shouting. God, I didn't like to hear that shouting."
He stopped and took a long drink.
"Anyway, that's what I'm considering. If she went in there, it's not as if we'd all vanish from her life. Absolutely. Also, said Sean, keeping his just the facts, Mum, voice going, I've been worrying about... Mum always sort of made out that what you two and she did was, like, important, that something terrible might happen if she stopped.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.